everyone. Today, I want to talk about one of history's most famous reptiles. It's called the Plesiosaur, an iconic predator from the Mesozoic era, who, let's just be honest, really needs no introduction. Whether it be images of ancient sea monsters, or the 24-meter-long Liopleurodon from Walking with Dinosaurs, or even our friend Nessie here, plesiosaurs are just as ingrained into our culture as dinosaurs such as T-Rex and Triceratops. But wait a second. One of these things is not like the other. What's with old Stumpy Neck here? Well, that's sort of the reason why I waited so long to do a video on these guys. Animal taxonomy can get pretty convoluted, especially when it comes to extinct animals. For instance, this animal here is called a Plesiosaurus. It's part of the order of Plesiosauria. Within this order, there are two different groups. On the left, we have Plesiosaurs, who are the ones with those iconic long necks. Then on the right, we have their shorter-necked brethren, who we call Pliosaurs. Basically, we separate them by whether or not they have a long or short neck. Our friend Plesiosaurus here is a member of the Plesiosaur group, which is within the order of Plesiosauria. Sounds simple, right? There's no way anyone could possibly confuse any of these names, not when we separate everything into neat little categories like this. It helps keep us organized, except when it doesn't. Sometimes, the lines start to blur, and members of the Plesiosaur group also have short necks, and members of the Pliosaur group have, well, you can probably guess where I'm going with this. It's complicated, and way too much for this little monster to cover in one video. So to keep things simple, we're just going to focus on the group that made these animals famous, the long-necked Plesiosaur. Now, for many of you, when you think of Plesiosaurs, two images come to mind. My good friend and fellow monster Nessie, or those iconic images of giant sea serpents battling sailors among the crashing waves. However, our modern view of them is quite different. Today, we know them to be prehistoric oceanic super predators with long and stiff necks. But why do they even have those long necks in the first place? After all, it's the ocean. Even if they needed those long necks to reach the tall trees, you can just float up, buddy. Despite being such a well-known animal, plesiosaurs haven't received much attention outside the role of playing the archetypical sea monster. Believe it or not, these animals have an interesting history. In fact, some of them even rivaled the largest super predators of all time. So today, we're taking a look at the history of the plesiosaurs and discovering their role in what was the Royal Rumble of the Mesozoic era. Don't forget to hit that like button, and let's dive into this. The year is 1867, and I have here with me the fossils of a massive plesiosaur. Now, it's important to note that we didn't just discover this animal. We've actually been collecting their fossils for several decades now. In fact, world-renowned fossil hunter Mary Anning discovered a nearly complete skeleton almost 40 years ago. So then, what makes this one so special? We're gonna get to that. First, I need to give a shout-out to Mary Anning. Mary was a fossil hunter in the 1800s, and she's responsible for several major discoveries along the Jurassic Coast, including a near-complete skeleton of both Ichthyosaur and the star of our video today, Plesiosaur. Today, her discoveries are celebrated, and she's considered a key figure in the history of paleontology. But as you can probably imagine, the acknowledgement of her legacy is a bit of a recent affair. Sadly, the 1800s wasn't the best time for a woman in science, or industry, or academia, or really any woman who wanted to vote or think freely. We've come a long way since then. Anyways, I just wanted to acknowledge Mary's role in the discovery. Now let's get back to this fossil someone gave me. You are probably wondering, what makes this particular fossil so special? Well, I'm supposed to wait for whoever's office I'm in to return before putting this thing together, but I'm sure they won't mind if I get started without them. Besides, I'm quite the Lego master. The shin bone's connected to the this bone, the leg bone's connected to the whatever this is. Hold up a minute, let me grab some glue. Just jump forward a little bit. There we are, all done. Just look at this baby. Isn't it a thing of beauty? What do you mean I put the head on the wrong side? Oh, I'm sure it's fine. I'll just leave it here how it is. This scientific blunder led to the most famous rivalry in all of paleontology, the Bone Wars. The owner of the office was a man named Cope, who was humiliated by the mistake when it was pointed out by his future rival, Marsh. Whoops, sorry about that. But what's more important is that this is a skeleton of, is that a plesiosaur? Yes. Yes, it is. But it's not just any plesiosaur. This is a plesiosaur known as Elasmosaurus. Cool, it looks just like Pleomosaurus from earlier. You mean plesiosaurus? What I said, exactly. Well, anyways, both of them are plesiosaurs, but what makes Elasmosaurus so special is that it's the archetype for that iconic image of plesiosaur stretching its neck above the waterline. Even though we all know this image is complete fabrication, the scale and grandeur of this animal is perfectly illustrated by the sheer size of Elasmosaurus, which, I have to say, is a nice change of pace. In my previous videos, we've talked about how Ichthyosaurus is the poster child for all ichthyosaurs, and how Mosasaurus tends to be what people think of when they think of Mosasaurs in general. This makes it a bit difficult to talk about them as all their names start to blur together. But thankfully, we don't have that problem when talking about plesiosaurs, as no one thinks of plesiosaurs when they think about plesiosaurs. Instead, We imagine its larger cousin, Elasmosaurus, going head-to-head with the other aquatic titans of the era, such as Mosasaur and other Plesiosaurs. So, how did Elasmosaurus stack up to those other giants? The animal measured around 10 meters in length, making it slightly smaller than its rival, Mosasaur. Much of that size came from its extraordinary long neck, which made up over 70% of its body length. The necks of Elasmosaurus could contain up to 76 vertebrae, which allowed the animal to reach extreme lengths. But I'm not going to lie to you all. As you saw with Mosasaur, even though the scale of this animal is impressive, its size compared to some of the other super predators of the time is lacking. It's not winning any boxing matches, which is great because with a long neck like that, it would never see me coming. However, that long neck must have been useful for something, as plesiosaurs are one of the most successful marine reptiles to ever live. They witnessed the rise and fall of those reptilian dolphins known as ichthyosaurs, and they managed to live side by side with the ferocious mosasaur up until the KT extinction event that wiped out the dinosaurs. Put simply, these animals have a long track record, thriving from the early Jurassic period all the way up until the end of the late Cretaceous period and spanning the entire globe. In fact, we recently discovered a large Elasmosaurus off the coast of Antarctica, called Marambios Nectes Molina. There's no way that's correct. It's named in homage to the island where the fossils were found, and the discovery of this animal is important, as it adds to the growing list of prehistoric animals discovered in the Arctic. That topic really deserves its own video. When you see how much further north the continent of Antarctica was during the Mesozoic era, it becomes clear just how much information is missing from our history. We finally had to address the elephant in the room. What's going on with that neck? Why do Elasmosaurus, and plesiosaurs in general, have such long necks? Well, for starters, long necks aren't as uncommon as you might think. Today, when we think of animals with long necks, the first thing that probably comes to our minds is a giraffe. But several other animals, such as birds, camels, and alpacas, also have relatively long necks compared to their body size. Not to mention prehistoric animals such as sauropods, whose long necks appear rampant in the fossil record. So simply having a long neck isn't all that uncommon. Still, the thought of diving underwater with a massive telephone pole for a neck doesn't seem like the best idea. Or does it? It turns out that having a long neck might have been more efficient for swimming than we previously thought. A good example of this is how when birds with long necks strike the water, their long necks help break apart the waterline and make it easier for them to catch their prey. That same principle also applies when swimming long distances, as it helps to break up the tension and balance the body as it moves through the water. However, it's far more likely that the purpose of those long necks was related to either some type of hunting behavior or even mating behavior. The most popular hypothesis is that the long neck would have helped plesiosaurs sneak up on their prey. Imagine for a second that you're the size of a small bus, and you really want to sneak up on that school of fish over there. This can be a difficult task, especially when the predators whom you are competing against are faster than you. As you can probably see, it's not looking good for our friend here. But what if your much smaller head arrived before your prey had a chance to see your large body? This would allow the plesiosaur to appear less threatening and make it easier for them to sneak up on their prey. Another hypothesis is that they could have used their long necks to scour the ocean floor looking for food. This idea is further supported by the range of motion these animals had with their necks. The early depictions of plesiosaur depict them using their necks to strike at their prey like a snake. Today we know that their necks would have supported very little motion, and that they wouldn't have been able to lift them very high, let alone bend and twist them as they were shown doing in those early depictions. Instead, their necks would have been stiff and the range of motion would have been limited to moving side to side and bending downward. So it's not very hard to imagine plesiosaurs sitting in one spot and feeding on smaller fish on the ocean floor. I have to say, I really like this idea. As a fellow potato myself, that's the best way to do it. Hunting for food takes up a lot of energy, but if you play your cards right, you can cover a lot more ground without ever having to leave your chair. For plesiosaurs, their long necks would allow them to cover a wide range of feeding areas without having to expend very much energy. This means that they would have had more energy for other things such as long-distance travel and migration. And wouldn't you know it, that's exactly what the fossil record shows us, with Mosasaurus seeming to feed off the coast and Plesiosaurus hunting further out at sea. To make those long journeys, Plesiosaurus utilized a unique swimming method that differed greatly from their prehistoric cousins. The other marine reptiles of the time mostly relied on their tails to propel themselves forward. This allowed animals such as Mosasaur and Ichthyosaurus to gain a burst of speed and launch themselves at their prey. However, plesiosaurs use their large flippers like paddles to move themselves through the water. In my video on the mosasaur, I compared the movement of a plesiosaur to that of a sea turtle, moving their flippers up and then back to help them gently glide through the water. However, it's a new day and I'm a smarter monster, so I don't think that's the best comparison anymore. Sea turtles tend to have long exaggerated movements, and research shows that plesiosaurs would have had a shorter thrust. It turns out that there's another animal alive today that might actually give us a better idea of how this animal actually swam. A ferocious Arctic predator who's known for extreme speed. You all can probably guess where I'm going with this. I'm talking about penguins. Just look at them go. Give them some time. They're getting there, I swear. Okay, maybe not on land, But in water, penguins use their flippers to propel themselves forward and fly through the water at incredibly high speed. It's possible that the plesiosaur also could have moved in a similar fashion, using its flippers to dart through the water, moving swiftly as it searches for prey. However, as you've probably noticed, there's a few issues with this model. For starters, once again, we have to talk about that neck. While it's possible the long neck of plesiosaur could help them maintain their speed while swimming in a straight line, the neck would have proved a detriment when trying to change directions. In addition to the neck, unlike penguins, plesiosaurs also had a secondary set of flippers in the rear that could have either been used as a secondary means of propulsion or simply used to change directions. The paleontology community still seems split on this issue, but a recent study in 2017 by Luke Muscat might have finally solved the mystery. To do this, Luke used a complex mathematical equation to determine— I'm just kidding with you, they built a robot. A what now? A model robot. By studying the movements of other animals such as penguins, turtles, and even seals, they were able to come up with a range of motion for the front and back flippers to determine if using the rear flippers to propel themselves forward would offer any benefit. And it turns out, they would! But the model also shows that the rear flippers would also increase the animal's efficiency when changing directions. So to answer the question of whether or not the rear flippers were used to help move the animal forward, or if they were used to change directions like a rudder, the answer is yes! In recent years, paleontologists have uncovered an increasing number of plesiosaur fossils, which has led to more and more types of different plesiosaurs being described each year. Some of these newly discovered creatures are small, roughly half the size of a modern dolphin, while others, like our enormous friend Elasmosaur over here, could even reach lengths comparable to that of a large shipping container. We have even found a new species related to Elasmosaurus called Aristonus neckes, who is just as large. What I really like about this creature, assuming I got its name right, is that its size wasn't simply all in the neck. This animal has a much girthier presence about it, which to me makes it seem more impressive. Imagine running into that thing while in the ocean. There's something about having a long neck that kind of makes it look like you're cheating on size a bit. Maybe that's why plesiosaurs seem to get more screen time. We all remember Predator X, a massive plesiosaur whose size rivals that of the mighty Kronosaurus. Predator X has had its share of controversies as the History Channel special on it aired on television before the animal was properly described. Since then, we've learned a lot about Predator X, including giving it a proper name. But unfortunately, we're out of time, so I guess we'll have to leave the story of the plesiosaurs for another video. Until then, I want to thank you all for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing to my channel, and don't forget to bring snacks.